before I cannot join because
okay.
I still in office at the moment.
All right.
So yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hope you enjoy our class tonight, Mas Fikri.
Yeah, I hope.
Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, I will learn. Yeah.
Yeah. Great. Yes, and we've got also anyone else joining us for the first time?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, hang on. Who is that?
Hi, Ayat.
Miss Ayat. All right.
Ayat.
Okay, where are you, Mbak?
I come from Bima, West Nusa Tenggara.
Wow. So you are now in Bima?
Yes.
Wow. All right. Looks like our participants are from all around the world. Okay, that's too much exaggerating. Yes, I know. Yeah, but yeah, I think it's not just anyone from Jogja. I think the Zoom connects everyone from anywhere. Right. Okay, I think because it's about the time. Okay, I don't want to delay any more minutes. I'll just start our session tonight. All right. I think I should greet everyone here in Zoom and also on YouTube. Everybody, you are now live on YouTube. Okay. Right. So first thing first, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
All right. Good evening, everyone. It's really good to see you again. And for those who come for the first time, welcome to Speak Up in this community. All right. So I hope everybody is doing just fine. Well, you join this class, then you are fine, right? All right. Tonight, our guest is as special as previous classes. Tonight, we're going to talk about batik. Okay, we've got Miss Karina Rima Melati. She's a lecturer, she's a batik entrepreneur, she's a batik artist. She's multi-talented and basically so into batik. Right, and also tonight we are not alone because I've got a great team supporting this event. Okay, and later I'll introduce you to everyone. Okay, for now, first, I think I'm going to share what we are going to do tonight. So allow me to share the agenda or the rundown for today. Right here. Okay, so today we're going to have focus group discussion. Okay, later after the main presentation from Ms. Rima. Okay, before the main presentation though, I'm going to share some information about Cilacs. There is new information that I think is going to be useful for you to know. Okay, and later after the focus group discussion, there is a group presentation from each group. Okay, I hope you already checked the group in the WhatsApp group, your group, for the breakout group, for the focus group discussion. So later you are going to be with our facilitators for focus group discussion and then also for the presentation. Okay, if we have time, we will also open a question and answer session with Ms. Rima, and we want you to fill out a feedback form. And there is also today's speak, so I'm going to share what some of the words that Ms. Rima later will tell us. And we're going to close that with a photo session. Oh, we're going to have two photo sessions actually, before the closing and after the presentation. Okay, right. Is everybody wearing batik today? I guess so. Most of you, I think. But if not, it's okay. It's okay. I won't send you out of this Zoom. Don't worry. All right. Okay, I think I'm just going to the next agenda. Well, basically, I have opened this session, and I'm just going to ask our host media handler to share a video. But before that, I want to say hi again to our viewers on YouTube. So how many viewers have we got there? 50 million? All right, great. Great, we've got 50 million viewers. All right, okay. Now, first, before I ask our Zoom host to share a video about Cilacs, I want to introduce our team tonight. Okay. So I've got, hang on. Mas Adit, he is our media handler or our Zoom host tonight. Mas Adit?
Hello, everyone. Joy.
Okay, yes. Thank you, Mas Adit. And we've got also Miss Dinar.
Hi, everyone. Let's speak up. Enjoy.
Great. Thank you, Miss Dinar. And we've got Miss Pinta.
Hi. Nice to see you.
Great. So Miss Dinar and Miss Pinta are our technical co-hosts. So they admit you to the Zoom room and also later help you with the focus group discussion rooms. All right, and of course we've got our facilitators tonight. I think Mas Dinsa already joins us. Hello, Mas Dinsa.
Yeah, hello there. Hello,
everybody. Ah, there. Great, thank you, Mas Dinsa. And we've got also Mas Fahrur.
Hi everyone, nice to see you. See you in room two.
Great, in room two later with Mas Fahrul. Thank you. And we've got also Mas Wahyu, Mr. Wahyu.
Hello guys, glad to see you. Have a good night.
Great, thank you Mas Wahyu. And we've got also Mas Yuga.
Hi guys, nice to meet you. I'm going to be in room four, so I'll see you there.
All right. Thank you. So in room four later with Mas Yuga. And our one and only lady in the facilitator lineup is Miss Amalia.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. I'm Amalia, and I'll be your facilitator. See you later during our FGD.
Yeah, thank you, Miss. Great. So this is our team members for tonight who help you with the class tonight. So I think without further ado, I'm going to ask Mas Adit, you know Mas Adit already, to play a video for us. Mas Adit, is the video ready? Right. Video helps you know more about Cilacs. All right. Okay. I think without further ado, I think I'll just ask our presenter tonight, Ms. Rima, to join us. But before that, I need to tell you something about her. Well, she's a lecturer. She's been teaching for perhaps more than 5 years. She has more than 8 years of experience in teaching. Well, it's really interesting subjects that she teaches. Hang on, I've got a file blocking. Wait, I have my cheat here. Hang on. I got a cheat about her. Wait, I need to read that for you. Okay. Yeah, she's got more than 8 years of experience in teaching, especially media. Okay. Advertising, digital media, media and culture, and so on. So well, she's a very well experienced lecturer. She's also a batik owner, a batik shop, a batik industry owner. So she's a batik entrepreneur, basically. She's got Plus Batik, that's the brand of her batik. And it focuses on improvement of batik industry. And she's also, like what I said before, a batik artist, a batik designer, she's a batik activist. She's a curator, so she's everything. She's so into batik, so yeah, that's her. I think we should welcome her now. So Miss Rima, Karina Rima Melati, the screen is yours.
Oh, thank you, Miss Henny. Okay, hello everyone. Good evening. I hope you all are doing great. Especially today is the Friday. And tomorrow we're going to have the weekend. But before weekend, I would like all of you to talk about batik. And it's really honor for me. Thank you, Cilacs, for having me in this SpeakUp. Because I've been doing batik at least 12 years. And I'm going to show you my recent project on batik. I hope you guys enjoy it. Okay, let me share screen first. I hope, oh yeah, I already have the access. Okay. Does everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. So clear.
Yeah. Okay. So today I'm going to talk about batik for a better life. So what is batik and what mean of a better life is? Mainly I'm trying to explain three things here, which is a pride that comes from batik. Secondly, the definition of batik and its development of this industry until this present day. And then the third, I want to propose the sustainability method to make batik a better life. So without further ado, let's begin. Okay. Firstly, Indonesia developed a very rich material culture and its elements become an important aspect for the country's national identity. So when it comes to cultural material, we can be proud of. And the world also widely recognize it. Not only batik, but also wayang papet, including gamelan, kris, pinisi, boat building from Sulawesi, angklung, pencaksilat, and maybe in the future, we have another list. And batik itself has been established as a country national identity. As you can see in the picture, President Jokowi with the Ministry of Cabinet Kerja in the first rule of his enrollment. And the second picture is President Soeharto during prestigious 1994 OPEC Summit, is the Organization of the Petroleum using Suharto and Brooke batik for at least 90 word readers. And I think if there are internet at that moment, it's already viral because 19 word reader wear batik. So yeah, not only that, I guess more than that, we are now celebrate what it's called euphoria of batik, where you can see batik almost everywhere. Batik already transformed from formal clothes to semi-formal, even daily clothes. We can see quite often batik become material of high fashion show in Indonesia, also in international event. Here is my favorite designer. This one is one of my favorite designer. He used batik as his material of creation, and not only from Indonesia but also international fashion designer Dries van Noten from Belgium also used batik as his collection in London Fashion Week. And another celebrity, not only in Indonesia, public figure, but also outside, also use the batik as a, you know, distinctive fashion. And another interesting thing is that we can also find batik almost everywhere, means in everywhere. We now have a plane named Batik Air, using the motif, and also the train with the decoration inside or interior design using batik. And even a jersey, this is from local football club, PSM, using kawung and parang, and even slippers using parang motif, when back in 100 years ago, this is impossible because parang only wear for sultan or nobleman or high rank status person. So this is, or we can call it motif larangan or forbidden motif. Okay, let's move on. And then Indonesia batik has been growing as a local and global perspective until UNESCO acknowledged it as intangible cultural heritage in 2009. This also national prize, and then not long after that, the government announced every 2nd October as the National Batik Day. So now is the 17th, so it's about 2 weeks from now, we will celebrate Batik, National Batik Day, and I hope you all prepare the best batik to be worn on the October 2nd. And so what is batik actually is? The word of batik is Indonesian origin or related to a Malay word, which is tik. Batik is, there's two words, a ba is came from amba, is a Japanese word of to draw. And tik is from titik, which is bahasa, which is Indonesian or Malay word, means dot or point. But the definition of batik related to the technique of making it. Basically, batik is a technique for decorating textile by which parts that are not to be colored are covered in molten wax. And that's become the batik motif. The wax prevents the textile from absorbing the dye or coloring during the decorating process. So waxing is the crucial element here, because if we don't use wax, means it is not batik. As you can see in the previous slides, jersey and slippers are just a textile with the batik motif. Or simply, we can say also printing. Sorry. So there are three techniques of making batik, which is already a national setting standard or SNI. there are tools or hand draw using pen-like tools called canting. So canting also the indigenous tools from Java, from this archipelago. The history of batik also related to the history of canting itself. So Rover, one of the first academic who doing research about batik, mentioning about cleansing batik motif that already known in 12th century in Kediri, East Java. If you understand, or if you like Panji story, there are cleansing in that story. So cleansing the meticulous and detailed motif can only be formed using canting. So Rover then argued that canting was discovered in Java in the same century. So it's been like 800 years of development. The second one is a stem or chopper stem chanting. We call it a batik chap. It's a block with the motif batik, and the chopper stem invited in 1845 when the development batik met the needs to fast and easy batik methods. Third one is the combining technique between the hand draw and stamp to get detailed, fast, and easy batik result. Okay, let's continue. I want to show you guys the major of batik motifs. In practice, there are significant difference in batik motifs, which influence by the people or by supporter in the region. But in general, batik perceived as the manifestation of ritual expression that is believed through the creation of its motif. So I will show you there are three batik motifs. First of all is geometric motif, which is decoration is full of symbolical meaning, influenced by Hindu and by Buddhist culture. And the geometric is developed in Kraton, Jogja, and in Solo. It's different from Cirebon because Cirebon is part of non-geometrical. I will show you later about that. And then some motifs were larangan or forbidden, as I mentioned before, because it's only, because since it's developed in the inside of the Kraton, it's also part, it's also have a symbolical meaning. So it's only it's forbidden for common people. And then the geometric, since because it is a full of symbolic meaning, also used for important events in human life, from birth, adulthood, marriage, until death. Most geometrical motifs use distinctive color called sogan, which is rich brown color. Okay, let's move on to another kind of motif, which is non-geometrical. Is a natural decoration which depicting real objects such as trees, flower, foliage, even as you can see in here. The third picture is a motif of Cinderella, which is made by Indo-European entrepreneur back in 1901 until 1950. And the second one is a Paksina Galiman from Cirebon. It is influenced by three different cultures, which is Arabic, and then India, and then China. And then this one is lunglungan, is a Pekalongan batik motif. Anyway, a non-geometrical is known, also well known as a batik pesisir, which is developed in area outside of Kraton Solo in Jogja, especially in north coast of Java, start from Cirebon, Indramayu, Pekalongan, Semarang, Lasem, Tuban, Madura, and even hinterland or downside the Java region island, such as Garut, Ciamis, Banyumas, Kebumen, Banyuwangi, also part of the Pesisir Batik. Batik Pesisir is very colorful. Is also including Bengkulu and Jambi. As I mentioned before, this Batik Pesisir reflecting foreign influence from China, Arabic, India, and Europe. As you can see here, there is a Indo-European or mixed blood community who not only wore batik but also make for their community. And obviously, this is China because a lot of batik. If you understand or love batik very much, you must be know that a lot of Chinese influence in batik. And yeah, batik is almost wear to daily activity for local as well. Okay, I'm gonna explain you another motif, which is contemporary motif. This motif is a freestyle or non-pattern decoration created by artists or painter, actually painter, the first one who made it, which is used batik as the medium of expression. Start from 1990s, but then right after UNESCO giving the certificate of World Heritage to Indonesian batik, batik maker, producer, fashion designer start to make contemporary batik motif based on their idea or standard, which is non-conventional rules. Some motif even called the motif by their name. So here's the motif is quite different from the previous one. And this is, I want to show you, this is my creation in plus batik. With contemporary motif batik is stylish, modern, also fashionable, and the color is also contrast. And not only that, some contemporary design also influence or pick up from classic motif, but design with the own way. I also wear it tonight. Anyway, okay, let me continue because I don't want to run out of the time. So I'm gonna show you batik industry. Now we are move on to the economic and dynamic of its supporter in the industry. Okay, the industry itself began around 1870 in order to increase number of demand. Many local women, so the beginning is when local women before they only make batik for their own family and then start to sell batik cantik but uncolored or not colored yet to the Chinese entrepreneur. And then because Chinese understand the opportunity of selling batik in the store, they bought the batik from the local woman and then color it or dye it in the backyard of their home. But then the industry mechanism start to get more organized when Indo-European also produce batik on their own home. They generate work system which make a worker employed in the same place, which is in their home, with the division of labor according to the stage of batik making. So this division of labor, there are many kind of division here, start from pre-treatment, pattern making, chanting, cholet or brushing color, tembokan or melted wax block, and celup or remove wax. So this division of labor is the method of batik manufacturer is even still, we can still see until this present day. And but back in the first or in the beginning of the industry, local women, which is previously made batik for their internal family, then start to work in batik manufacturer. So this is quite a transcultural, especially for women in the central batik. Okay. And the local lifestyle, which is before they are before agrarian and later become laborer in the European or Chinese entrepreneur. I want to show you a little bit or I want to illustrate it to you a little bit dynamic of the industry. So after the independence, the Sukarno make movement, which is called Batik Indonesia in 1950, which is developed the motif from outside of Java. So as the result now, you can see there is a batik from Papua, from Kalimantan, from Sulawesi and stuff like that. So it's, the beginning is around 1950. From Sukarno. And but then the peak of glory of industry is around 1970 when the government also made rules for the people, especially the workers, to wear batik as a uniform. But the industry experienced collapse during 1998 economic crisis, and also at the same time printing or textile with the batik motif from outside of the region or even from China happened to be invaded the market, the batik market. So at that time the batik start to collapse. Okay. Not long after that, after the collapse, during 2009, we can see that the batik start to, start to become a trend. Especially if you still remember, there is a sentiment from Malaysia. To admit batik as their cultural. At that moment, Indonesian start to start to make sure that batik is their own material of culture. Okay, anyway, I hope I'm not running off the time. I'm gonna show you the main slide, which is the problem in the midst of splendor in the batik industry. Okay. So even though we are experiencing the euphoria, as I mentioned, we have a lot of challenges. Wastewater is a big problem. Wastewater is a limbah. The wastewater is came from the chemical dyeing or chemical color. And most of the batik craftsmen or batik owner throw their wastewater directly into river nearby their manufacturer. In 2019 report mentioned that only 45% of wastewater is managed in IPAL or wastewater treatment plant. So it is a serious problem because it's damaging river ecosystem, such as killing the animal who lives inside the river. And in the long term, will contaminating well water or air sumur. If it is polluted, the well water, and be consumed, community will generate a various disease. From diarrhea is very obvious, even cancer. And the worst is a story from Pekalongan where people who consume the the water from the river experience gene mutation where they cannot grow because of the synthetic elements that they consume. Not only.
Sorry, Mbak Rima, I need to interrupt you. You've got 3 minutes. Just a reminder of the time. 3 minutes left. Sorry.
Okay. 3 minutes.
Sorry. Okay. Go on, let please. Me, thank you.
Let me try to do it fast. Okay. Sorry. Let me share you again. Okay. Wage or salary is a serious problem because the labor experience low wage or low salary. Because it is very contrast from today's batik trend, because they only have a minimum, not only minimum, but even less than UMR or minimum wage, monthly minimum wage. The issue for batik labor happens since it become the industry. Low bargaining position due to one part of work or division labor is the main reason they cannot do much about it. And not only that, lack of opportunity is also become the reason why they only have a few, they only earn a few. Batik for some of the labor also only consider as side job. And but I have to mention that the intangible cultural heritage is not only for the motif, but actually for the experience who making it. So the reward is basically for the experience of making it, not only the batik motif itself. So the one who make it, which is labor, should be recognized in the first place. Okay. Some conclusion. Okay, batik is a pride, not only national identity, but batik shape who we are today. As you can see, batik is a generate culture from every foreign who live in Indonesia, who live in this archipelago. So from the community, the culture, the art, and the dynamic of action behind its development. Most of batik making is a home industry or small medium enterprises that absorb labor and support the national economy. Even during the pandemic, SMI or UMKM is a big step for rebuild the economy of national economy. Challenges and problems needs to be done, or batik will be degradation and torpor will be happen again. I'm going to propose, so what should we do? And this is part of the discussion that we're going to do. I'm going to propose a slow fashion to sustain the industry. Fashion is the second largest polluted industry in the world. The second one is the mining. Because the world already overwhelmed with the environment destruction through the fashion industry making. Not only wastewater for one single clothes need at least 2017 liters clean water or equal to 3 years water supply for one person. So a single clothes equal to 3 years water supply for each person. So this is a big number. This is a serious problem. And batik as a fashion, part of the fashion industry, is also responsible for that event. fast fashion forced to follow the trend. Because of the fast fashion follow the trend in it, because it needs to make fashion as fast as possible. And also not only that, the price is also very cheap. And a lot of waste, especially the chemical waste. The producer or brand needs a lot of resource and enforce their staff to work more effective and efficient, but they pay very less. Change the perspective means change the lifestyle and become a movement. So for the movement is for the owner, they can apply what is called slow fashion because it's more sustained for the industry. As, for example, by managing wastewater, applying pre-order to make sure that the clothes, each clothes they made for a good reason. And for the worker with the slow fashion, is more focused to high quality product, and they also have a payment. And for the customer, please choose wisely and become responsible consumption for their product that they bought or they choose. If slow fashion can be applied, certainly the industry and batik itself can sustain. And our life can be much more better. Thank you. And I think I need to explain it right now, Miss Henny.
Okay. Please. But please make it.
Excuse me. Okay, let me explain. So I want all of the participants discuss what would you do if you are batik owner, batik labor, or batik consumer. Please choose one of it, and then from the perspective that I already give in the slides, choose wisely which one for you to become part of the owner, labor, or consumer. To the purpose is to make a batik a better life. Especially, I already mentioned about the problem or the challenges in the batik industry. So yeah, I want all of you to have a point of view about this situation.
Okay. Is that it, Ms. Rima? Yes. Is that all? Great. Yes. Thank you very much. Okay, everybody, could you please turn on your mic and let's give applause for Mbak Rima. Yay.
Yay. Good job.
Yeah, it was a great presentation. Very rich of information. Yeah, I think it opens our eyes, opens our mind about batik. We know more about batik now. All right, everyone, thank you, Ms. Rima. We're going to send our participants to the breakout room for further discussion. Okay, with the breakout room later, you're going to go with your facilitators for the discussing what Ms. Rima has told you. But before that, hang on, I think we've got our participants coming and going out of, in and out of Zoom because of the connection. So I think it's better for us to take a few screenshots, some pictures now. Okay, before I'm losing everybody. All right, so Mas Adit, are you there to help us with the photo?
Let's take the picture. Okay, so please turn on your camera, please. Everyone, please turn on your camera. But Mbak Eni, could you please to help us to capture the screen because there is a delay in my screen. Yeah.
Okay. Oh right. Okay. I'll also do it. Okay. So on your mark, must edit this.
Yeah.
We wait for you to count so we can be ready. And okay. Or what kind of pose should we do? Any pose?
Yeah, we can use our symbol, letter of C, the C letter like this. So please use your right hand and shape it like a C letter like this. Okay, everyone ready? Okay. Mbak Eni, I think we can take the picture right now.
All right.
Can you help me, Mbak Eni?
Yeah, sure. I'm taking it.
Yeah. Okay. We have two pages here.
Oops, I'm moving it to the second page. Hang on.
Okay, wait.
It's hard. I have to use my two hands. Okay. All right. Must I just keep going? Keep going. That's all right. Okay, everybody, hang on. Hold your hands still. And I hope you won't get sore muscles later. All right. Okay. Anyway, let me insert the first one. Okay. Oh, are we done, Mas Adit? I haven't taken the second page.
Hold on. Okay. Yeah, okay. Enough.
Ah, all right. Great. Oh, I thought we're going to raise our hand for like 50 minutes. Okay. All right. I think it's time for you to go to the breakout room and have fun discussion with your friends. Okay. So again, check out your room number in the WhatsApp group. In room one, you're going to be with Mas Densa.
Mas Hello Densa there.
Is here? Yeah. There okay. He is. Okay. Good, thank you, Mas Dinsa. In room two, you're going to be with Mr. Fahrur.
Yes, Miss.
Yeah, great. And Mr. Wahyu in room three.
Yes, here I am.
Good. Mr. Yuga in room four.
Yes.
Okay, and Miss Amalia.
Room five.
Yes, room five, of course. All right, everybody, I think you can just go there. The breakout room is open. Is it? Can you see the breakout room notice?
Yes.
No? Yes, you will. Yes, okay, great. Okay, everybody, you can go there and have fun discussing with your friends. See you in 40 minutes. Participants are going to the breakout room, and I've got also a participant at my home, a gecko. Can you hear that? Okay. Right. Good. We've got some more friends going to the breakout room. All right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Oops. Yep. Oh, we still have some. Okay. All right. While we are waiting for our participants to join, I think they can start discussing now. And I'll just go back to Ms. Rima. So Ms. Rima, are you ready to give some more insight for our YouTube viewers?
Okay.
All right.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Do you check our YouTube?
Not yet. I need to focus on you right now.
Oh,
I'm nervous. That's why I want to make sure that I focus on one thing, which is you right now.
Oh, you're focused on me. Okay. All right. Okay. I think this is what I can ask you first. I'm still curious about your background. You know, like yes, I got your CV, so I know that you're a batik enthusiast. But tell me about your background more, so our YouTube viewers can also know more about you.
Okay, what should I start? Maybe I want to explain you about my discipline. I mean, my major basically is not batik. My discipline is a design or advertising, but ended up involved with batik from my mom. My mom shaped a lot of who I am right now, especially in the batik. So me and my mom in 2009 or 2010, during that time, we start the Jenggolo, or it is the batik studio, but mainly we focusing on empowering women nearby our home to produce or to make batik. First of all, we thought, well, let them to experience how to make batik. But then later on, they also earn a lot of, some of money from it. And since that, the involvement with the batik is more bigger and bigger. And yeah, not only that, I also done some of batik research because I think unconsciously I already entailed with the batik since I was a little child. My mom, who retired from Balai Batik, is the government office for batik and craftsman. She brought a lot of batik when I was a child. So I smell the lilin or the wax. Is I don't know, but whenever I smell it, even until now, I get excited.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And then again, that my family background also, I came from the root of batik. My great grandmother is a batik maker in Kebumen. And that's why my grandfather, which is a painter, my late grandfather, involved batik motif to his artwork. So yeah, batik been part of my life like a long time. And then I want to explain you more about the research that I done in the batik area, because
that's interesting.
Yeah, because I have a curiosity about batik. Not only I only see or smell the wax, but then I start to get to know about the motif, the aesthetic one, and in the politic and the economic politic of the community who made it. And I done a master thesis get know more about the dynamic of community in Pekalongan who make batik with what it's called batik buketan. Because Batik Buketan is very much involved from three different community, from Indo-European, and then from local, and then the third is from China Peranakan or Chinese Peranakan. Yeah, and in Jogja I also done the batik labor in Imogiri, and I also have been produced or as part of the author of the book from batik lover community. We call it Sekat Jagat. So we just published the batik nitik, because batik nitik is originally from Jogja and is already have the identical geographies from the Ministry of Kemenkumham. What is it?
Okay, the Ministry of Law and Human Rights.
Yes.
Yes. Wow.
Yeah, and not only that, in Jenggolo, me and my mom also, and the member of Jenggolo also train batik for the community, especially women in the part of Jogja, even until Ternate. In 2009, we went to Lubuk Linggau in Sumatra and in Kebumen as well. So yeah, I've been traveling with my mom to teach or train. But now, since my mom passed away in the early this year, now I'm focusing in plus batik.
But so Jenggolo is still there or no?
I think it's transformed to be plus batik, but the mission is still the same, to make a batik for a better life. That's the mission of Jenggolo or in plus batik as well.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, wow, that's very interesting. You are almost the whole life is influenced by batik, yeah. since you were born. Wow.
Yeah, because I'm lucky, because I have the historic background from my family, mom and from my dad. So yeah,
that's right. Yeah, I think you are very lucky. Not everybody has that kind of chance, you know, born in a family of batik enthusiasts, like you have the batik gene in your blood. The batik blood is there with you. Wow. That's amazing. I think
blood is a perfect word for me, because I done the presentation in international panels seminar, and some of the participant even doesn't recognize where Indonesia, but they amazed by the beauty of batik. And then during the event, I always, you know, wear batik and with the sarung and even kebaya. So those things make them like call me batik girl.
Oh wow, that's cute, batik girl. You must be stunning and, you know, attract attention, because what you wear is totally, you know, different, stand out.
Yeah, that's my purpose actually. I want,
of course, yeah.
I'm a little girl who in a big city. I want to you know, recognized. So that's why I wear batik, the distinctive color and motifs, and then everybody's staring at me.
That's great, I think. Wow. Okay. So so it is like batik is your reason for everything, yeah, because based on your personal experience, based on your family background as well, batik is really play a really big role in your life, and it becomes perhaps a major thing now in your life.
Yeah.
So with your activities in batik, can you tell us more about your activities?
I want to tell more about batik. So
right, yes,
I have to mention my friend. He's a Japanese, and he love or he acknowledged batik from his mother, and that's why they go back to Java many quite sometimes. And he asked me to make batik or produce batik in a different way. So his name is Shuta, and he said that his perspective is almost the same, but a little bit different from what I did in Cenggolo, because as a Japanese, he have a bigger perspective of what happened in the batik industry, right? So he proposed the method or the method of producing batik, but especially how to make sure that it's good for the environment. He done some little research about the wastewater or air limbah, which is very serious. Even myself, I done batik with Cenggolo for quite some time, and still haven't realized how serious it is, limbah or wastewater for the environment. And in Pekalongan, as you can see in the slide, I just saw there is a colored river. So the river with the color is scary actually. And if you also see the slide, I also show you the Google Earth picture from the satellite. It shows the black spot just outside the river in Pekalongan. Maybe a few months ago, there is a flood, like big flood in Pekalongan, and there is a color of the water. It's funny, but yeah, I also laugh at it. But it's a serious problem because when I think people haven't realized the impact of it. Especially if the wastewater contaminate the well or well water, air sumur, and then consumed by people, it's maybe the impact is not, you know, now or a few days again, but it's a long-term impact. A lot of research mentioning cancer, and then also, like I said, gene mutation or mutasi gen.
Yes.
And diarrhea is very obvious, and also skin bruises. A lot of diseases will be impacted by the wastewater. And the things is still a little people who realize it, and educate by it.
Yeah.
So what I do in Plus Batik with Shuta is we make sure that the waste from the chemical dye will be treatment in the ipal. So we generate a simple ipal, and then we try to maintain the waste and make sure that it is already safe or based on baku mutu. We call it baku mutu. It's a standard. It's a national Indonesian national standard for the waste. Because we produce in the very dense community, so we want to make sure that it's not harming the environment. And yes, it is not only long and expensive also, but I guess that's the pay that we have to, that's the value that we have to pay if we want this industry to be sustained. I think at the same time, we already aware about the global warming, about the national or destruction because of the
climate change.
Because of what?
Climate change.
Yes, because of the climate change. And this kind of movement, we want to become a movement to wastewater is very important to people or to community, to consumer, even for owner, batik owner, to understand the situation that we face if we don't care about it in the few or even near future. So yeah, I think we plan not only for Plus Batik, but we try to cooperate with others NGO, especially in Dian Desa, and Pustekling is a laboratory for wastewater. And we also want to other batik entrepreneur to do the same as we are to maintain or treatment their wastewater in a way there is a cost to make it to treat the wastewater. But I believe that the more we aware, the more we accept this accept the methods.
Right. Yes.
So thank you for Cilacs for having me in this kind of event, so I can explain to you more about the important to treatment the wastewater. And
yeah,
as I mentioned also, Miss Henny, that fashion industry is the second biggest industry who polluted.
Yeah, right, exactly.
After mining industry, so it's just like the second biggest polluted industry. I think people just like, or you know, producer or brand, fashion brand, too selfish, you know. Because for the sake of the trend, they want to make as much as profit they want. They produce a lot of even some of the brand fashion maintain to have 1 week clothing theme. So everyone, they will change the theme of the product.
Oh, okay. Wow. So yeah. The collection is new every week.
Yes, the collection.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Wow, that's really hard to follow.
Yeah, for big brand who apply the fast fashion, the consequences is very, is everywhere, especially not only harming the environment, for sure, as I mentioned, one single quote using at least 2,700 clear water. Whoa. So equal to 3 years of single people for drink water.
Whoa.
So it's actually important to acknowledge this. And when the clear water also become wastewater, is another problem, is another serious problem.
Yeah.
Yes, so we in Plus Batik, we want to make sure that we apply the slow fashion, what it's called, slow fashion. So that's why we make sure that every product that we made will be buy in the good reason, for a good reason. So we apply pre-order.
Okay.
So it's not, we not only make a mass production, we don't want to make it into mass production, but we want to make sure that person who buy it, they really want it. They really understand. Even we also mentioned that batik that we made is responsible to the nature. There's a cost of treatment the wastewater, and then there's a cost of make sure that the our staff paid well. Because another problem in batik industry is the low wage for the labor. Some of them even only earn less than UMR or minimum monthly wage. Yes, and some of them even work daily, means that if they don't work, then they don't earn a single money. We want to make sure that Plus Batik doing such a thing that makes sure the environment is good enough, and also the staff. And the other things what we do in Plus Batik is we train or we make a workshop. A couple months ago, we cooperate with the Ministry of Kementerian Pemuda dan Olahraga, Young.
Okay.
Young
and like youth and sport.
Youth and sport. Yeah, we make a batik and jumputan trainer, and also we acknowledge them to understand the wastewater, because the participant were the one who some of them is a batik entrepreneur. And then the other trainer is we want to give upscaling workshop for the batik maker or the labor, because as I mentioned, the division of labor is it cause of the low bargaining position for the labor, because they only work in one part of the batik making. So if they understand more than one, they can adjust the wage.
Right. Yes. Okay. Wow. That's something very positive, and you know, it's inspiring actually. I think more people should hear about this. We don't really hear a lot about what happened behind the industry, you know, like, because what we see is only what people sell, you know. Batik everywhere is in every shop, it's in every places where people wear them, but we don't really know what happened behind or what happened before the batik is sent to this shop or worn by people. So like it's kind of what is it, really blow your mind.
Yes.
You know, because that's really
as well when I acknowledge it first time. Especially the cost of making one single clothes is equal to 3 years of clear water that we consume. And batik is kind of a shame to admit that batik is a national treasure, national identity, but behind that there is a big problem.
Yeah.
Wastewater is I think we me and Shuta now doing a little research about batik in Panda or in Bantul.
All right.
So we came there and we see the river, and we exactly at that moment we saw a fish who died, like dying, because the water from the wastewater from the producer just, you know, throw to the river, directly to the river. And we documented it, the fish is dying of because of that. And well, for me, Jogja is not as bad as Pekalongan, sorry to say, yeah, Pekalongan, I think because the industry there is very big.
Right.
Almost, yes. Well, I've done the research there as well. And the Dekranas mentioned that every five in seven house, so five in seven house, they make party.
Oh, wow, that's very massive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the industry there is very massive, and the water, the river itself, not only color, but the water is just like, it's not flooded, it's just like stop, like because of the material, synthetic chemical material
in the
water, inside of the water. Wow. And there is a report in 2019 mentioned that it's only 45% producer in Pekalongan who treat their wastewater in IPAL. It's not enough, because there it's a massive, as you said, it's a massive batik production.
Yeah. Mm. Oh. So why yes, some sources, a little, not really a little, just some of them have this wastewater treatment plant. Why not every house, or why not making a kind of communal? So what's the problem with this wastewater treatment plant there?
Yeah.
Like, is it not affordable, or is it because they're just too lazy to make it, or what?
Yes, first of all, I want to reflect myself back a year ago or 2 years ago when we still in Jenggolo. We maintain to have IPA or wastewater treatment plant.
Mm-hmm.
And it's quite difficult since we use a natural dye, so it's more like easier for us, you know, to. Mm-hmm. Well, we consider it's a safe to get to throw it directly to the river.
Yeah.
But then the producer who are still not aware of how serious problem it is if they throw it to the wastewater. Because first of all, I think the price of maintain the wastewater is very high. I can say that we spend in Plus Batik, yeah, we spend at least more than 500 rupiah or even 1 million rupiah only to buy the, what can I say, the obat for limbah, because it called obat, just to treat the wastewater.
I don't know what it's called, a formula?
Okay. Obat. It's a formula. But we call it obat, yeah.
Yep.
We have to spend at least that number. Sometimes if we make a lot of batik, we spend like 1 million to buy the formula. And the second one, not only buy the formula, but we also have to build the water plant, wastewater treatment plant. We make the simple one, and but it's also cost maybe until 3 million. So basically, because of the money we have to spend to treat the wastewater. There are communal wastewater treatment plant in some area of in the Central Batik, but even in Pekalongan, but the maintaining is we have to be consistent to maintain it well.
Right.
Maintaining is also another thing to do. You know, not only you have this and buy this, but if you don't maintain it well, then it's the same.
Right.
Yeah, I guess every producer have to make sure that they have some money to spend for such a thing to treat the wastewater. And then I think because the other reason is because there's still a few people who realize how serious it is. Because when we went to the Bantu, the Sentra Batik in Bantu, people will say it's okay, later on the wastewater will be fade and you know mixed with the other clean water, it's okay. And there's they said they don't face a problem in years. But I guess the knowledge or the how we can educate not only the worker, not only the owner, but also the consumer.
Yeah.
Consumer have to know the consequences. It's not only that they can buy you know, clothes and then that deal. There is a, you know, cost behind it that they have to pay for the next 5 years or 10 years.
If we don't
care about it.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, in Plus Batik, we want to educate it. We want to have some kind of fair trade, which is to make sure that the buyer know exactly how much they pay for, not only for the clothes, but for the mechanism, you know, to water, and then also for the labor and another activities for this movement.
Right.
This is such a project for actually for me and Shuta in Paspati, but we are exciting. We are so excited to do that.
Yes. I think that's right. You must be excited about it, and you have to be optimistic about it. Like, you know, the more people know about this or hear about this, I think it's going to be more helpful for Plus Batik and everyone who has the same vision as Plus Batik to realize the dream, you know, having sustainable industry with sustainable environment.
I also need to address as well, Miss Henny, mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. we are not trying to, you know, we are not trying to argue or have conflict with the government or the another party entrepreneur. Right. We want this to become a movement for all of us.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
What we do now is trying to provide data, evidence, and then the next is we want to make sure that the impact of it, and together we try to cope the situation or the problem together.
Oh, right. Mm-hmm. So like building awareness.
Yes.
Among this, as many people as we can, yeah. So we spread this mission and project and let everybody knows that this is important.
Yes. Know,
having this sustainable industry. Wow.
I guess that now a lot of people more aware about the you know, since the climate change or since the, you know, problem, destruction with the natural environment, more people aware of this issue. And I hope Paspati get more supporter, not only for Paspati. I think we also plan in the next 3 years, we want to cooperate with at least 100 party entrepreneur in Java to make a water waste treatment plant. That's our goal in 3 years. So this is a project for not only for cosmetic but for a lot of people.
Right. And it's a long-term project, and it's going to be a sustainable project for all parts of the industry.
Yes, because if we not start to do this, it's a shame because Batik is a national treasure.
Yeah.
But what happened is Batik is damaging our environment.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that batik should be stopped to produce again. No, it is it is big thing. It is a important thing for workers because of the they earn from this industry. So we want to make sure that the industry is sustained for the next 100 years.
Yes, exactly. It's got to be sustainable, and if there are more people who are aware of it, then I think that's easier to achieve. Wow.
Yes.
That's great, I think. So have you got any other plans for the future, like besides, you know, the project of building this wastewater treatment plant? Are there any projects that you perhaps want to do or is planning to do related to your batik and the mission, of course?
We want to try to sell it outside of Indonesia. We want to export our batik.
That's great.
We want to make sure that the batik that we produce is sustainable. we want to spreading out the mission not only in Indonesia but outside of Indonesia, because some of the country already aware, like their customer is aware of this issue. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we hope, we also want to introduce Batik in a bigger market.
Great. That's
another dream that we want. And we, during the pandemic, we noticed that a lot of Batik entrepreneur who also struggling, and we want to also ask them to be part of to sell their batik to export it. I'm happy that I'm lucky because in Plus Batik we have Shuta. Japanese, so we hope that at least Japan will be the first country to be export our product.
Oh wow, that's good. I think so there's a way.
I hope so.
Great. Now one thing, this is a very basic question actually. If batik is made a kind of exclusively because it's made based on sustainable method, then is it expensive? Compared to the batik that we can buy anywhere. So how about the pricing then?
Okay, that's an interesting question actually. The what we call is slow fashion method, right?
Right. Yes.
So it's the opposite of fast fashion. So basically, fast fashion is the system how to make sure that the producer earn profit as much as they want, as much it could possibly is. But there are consequences of it, not only the waste, but also they enforce the labor to make the product as well, as fast as they have to. Not only that, the economic law allow when a lot of production means it can decrease the price. So the fast fashion can sell their price lower, but the quantity is bigger. But then the labor, they only earn a lot of it.
Okay.
Even I have the story that one of labor mentioned that they have to work from 8 in the morning until 11. Because of the system forced them to work as efficient, as effective as worker have to. And then, but then the fast fashion, they, because of the massive production that they have to make, and the time is also very fast, a lot of a lot of product is expired. So they can cost, they can sell it like a cheap price. So back to your question about how about the slow fashion, right? So what we want to make sure that we apply what it's called fair trade. We just make sure that we open we open the perspective of when every clothes that we made is cost, the customer have to pay like how much for the batik making, how much for the sewing, and how much the water waste treatment, and how much for make sure that this movement sustain, those kind of things. It costs, of course, it's different, but it's not, the customer not buy the clothes, not only buy the product, but they paid for the environment that still sustain, the workers that still be can earn money that is good enough. But I can make sure that the price is not, you know, as high as maybe you would expect it.
Yeah.
Right. We make sure that the price is we
still
will
affordable, yeah.
Yeah, still affordable. Okay.
All right. Yeah. Oh, sorry. So looks like we've got our participants coming back to the main room. They finished their discussion, and let's check. Did you have fun, everyone? How was the batik discussion?
It was great.
Ah, great. Good to hear that. Great. Okay. Glad you enjoy that. Okay. So, Mbak Rima, since our participants are coming back here, I think we can invite every representative of the group to tell us about what they have discussed in the breakout room. Okay, so I think I'll just going to invite someone from Mas Yuga's group.
Okay, Miss, thank you for the opportunity. So yeah, from our group, the one who will represent is going to be Miss Vida Savi. Please give it up for her.
Yay, Miss Vida.
Okay, exactly. I have a very, 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 very good discussion in my group with Mas Yoga. And I want to say something about batik. And I will think about the owner of perspective view. Oh, no, sorry. I will think about the labor. Some people say that they think about the low cost of wages for the labor. But if you know, batik is an art. And for the person who create batik motif like batik tulis, they enjoy it so much because batik tulis is their passion, because they think that batik is about how to enjoying their life, and they can show their idea, they can express their idea by writing batik tulis. Yeah.
Oh,
I think that's all.
Okay, great. Wow, that's amazing. Thank you, Mbak Vida and Mas Yuga. Thank you. Great, now I'm just going to call another person from a different group. Perhaps Miss Amalia's group?
Yeah, hello, Miss. Okay, so from our group, I have chosen Miss, wait. I forget.
Oh no, me?
Oh no. No. Wait, Miss
not me. Okay.
Not you. Wait a second. Miss. Oh my god. Oh, Miss Raras. Yeah, Miss Raras.
Oh, how
could you? My bad, Miss Raras.
Miss Pambayon Raras. Pambayon, are you the princess of Jogja?
Supposed to be the princess. No.
Miss Rana, I truly apologize. Okay, please.
It's okay.
All right, so thank you so much. Here I'm as the representative of my team. Okay. Here I'd like to talk in behalf of me as a Batik consumer, in which if I'm about to choose what kind of Batik motif that I want to wear, I'd like to choose something that is very versatile and is also everlasting type of product itself. In this case itself, Batik clothes. And okay, so here currently we say that we see that there are lots of innovations in or designs, especially in fashion industries. We can see that there are lots of batik motif that is really that were made by either handwritten one or either stamps clothes. They combine it with the most any kinds of another clothes itself, and it creates a very beautiful gown or very beautiful attire, which is very sophisticated to see and is very pleasing to see. I'm sorry, it's very pleasing to see. Yeah, if I'm have to choose itself, I'd like to choose that kind of batik motif. So one thing that is very that needs to be highlighted from my group's discussion is that how could the batik, especially an object itself, is able to make the betterment of like, yeah, in life itself. But then I come to the conclusion that it can be the betterment to someone who is really, who is strongly in touch, who is strongly in line with the batik industry itself. Because we can say that if we are the owner of batik, if we are the labor of batik itself, and if we are the consumer of that batik, we can say that our life can be, how to say, can be very influenced by the dynamic of batik pattern itself, right? And also the design itself. So maybe that's all. Thank you so much.
Wow, great. Thank you, Mbak Raras. Wow, awesome. Thank you, Mbak Raras and Miss Amal. Thank you.
Thank you, great. Mbak Raras. You. Awesome, good job.
Yay. Great, thank you. I'll just go to the next one. Okay, let's see. Who is it? Well, perhaps someone from Mr. Wahyu's group.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Henning. So great, I would, yes. We haven't decided the one who would like to represent our group, but okay, I would like to choose the one who has never been joining this speak up before. So it is the first time for her. Ms. Jordi's friend. Ms. Ayat, are you here? Yes, you're there, please.
Oh, Ms. Ayat. All right.
Okay. Actually, we talk about talk a lot about the batik. For example, like the owner, labor, and consumer. Since we have different opinion about the topic, so I just conclude what we discussed together in the breakout room. First, we talk about the owners, the batik owners. From this point, from the owner perspective, we need to look for the labor. The consumer, I mean the rank of the consumer for the batik, also the cost or the material that we use in the batik itself. For example, like we know that a product of batik in Java Islands, especially in Yogyakarta, but in other islands like West Nusa Tenggara and other islands, we don't have really have much batik product. For example, from my place as well, we didn't have a batik market here. So if we have the batik, it's very expensive. So we talk about the cost because we know batik is very difficult to produce. So if you want to produce or introduce the batik to other island, you need to calculate the cost, not that expensive or not that too cheap. So we can calculate for the consumer as well. And then we talk about how to introduce the batik to the younger generation. So we discussed that we should introduce the batik to the student as well. For example, introduce as one of the curriculum, like in the culture class, so they can love the batik from the youngest generation. Since for me, for many students now, wear batik, especially in Friday, but they didn't know much about the motif or how to make the batik. So maybe the curriculum from the government can introduce the batik to the student as well, so they know how difficult or how difficult to make the batik, and then they come to love the batik as well, since it is one of the local product of our country. So we need to love our own product. And then some my friends say that we will introduce the batik to national, even to the international states, like all over the world. So they want, as the owner, they want to introduce the batik even to the international place, like USA and many other countries across the world. Thank you, that's all.
Right, yay, wow. Okay, I'm just amazed because we've got three representatives and they were all great. You've got good opinions about batik. Wow. Okay. Right. We've got two more, and I think they will be as amazing as the three before them. So I'll just invite someone from Mr. Fahrul's group.
Okay, good, Ms. Henny. So in our group, in room two, we have Mas Nizar Sadat. So Mas Nizar, time is yours to present.
All right. Yes, Mas Nizar, please.
We have already talked about batik in group discussion. And so we talked about batik owners, batik lovers, and batik consumers. As owners, we should know how to good design, good marketing methods. And so as being a lover, we must make a good motif. And for as a consumer, we must choose price that match the quality. Okay, thank you.
Oh, okay. That's very short, but very to the point. And it was good point, yes. Great. Wow. Thank you, Mas Nizar. Thank you, Mr. Fahrul. It was great. Okay, we've got one more, the last one, but it's not the least. It might be the best. Mas Dinsa, your group, please.
All right, so we are the last one. Yeah. Thank you, Miss Annie, for the opportunity. Well, that was exciting discussion in group one, Miss Annie. And I would like to invite Miss Jenny to represent our group. So Miss Siti Mutiadini, the screen is yours. Thank you,
Mr. Dinsa, for the opportunity. Tonight, I will talk about batik from the owner perspective. If I am a batik owner, the top priority I will do, the first is preparing the waste management infrastructure. I do agree with Ms. Karina Rima Melati. The waste problem, the waste issue is a very crucial problem in the batik industry. So the top priority I will do is prepare for that. The second one, I will do research about the natural dye on the natural coloring method to replace the chemical dye. So it will safer and environmentally friendly. The next thing I will do is promote batik to the younger children. I think it is important also because the continuity of the batik industry laid on the younger generation. So if we cannot promote the batik to the younger children, or we cannot growth love or about batik, it will gone. And then the last one I will do is I will promote batik through the event, like international event, because I think it's very important to make global societies know that our identity is related to batik and how proud we are with batik. That's all, Mr. Henny.
Yes. Right. Yes. Thank you, Miss Jenny. It was, I think, also great. So we've got great representatives tonight. Wow. You should be proud of yourself, everyone. You had great discussion. I think it was fun, and your representatives, I think, really say what you have discussed. All right. I think I'll just go to Miss Rima and ask her. Her opinion about our representatives and our groups and our participants today.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much for the participant who already mentioning their thoughts during the discussion. And I really appreciate, especially if I can mention one of them, Ms. Siti Mutia, who realized, who acknowledged the important for the owner to prepare the wastewater treatment plan, because it's not only for their business, but also to sustain the industry for the next 100 years ahead. And also, I want to mention Ms. Aya, who also wants to introduce batik to the international market. Yes, that's what we in Plus Batik want to do, because batik is not only as a national identity, but when we can introduce batik to international market, is also grow the industry batik in Indonesia as well. And I guess one thing that is very interesting and also is Ms. Fida, because she said that the owner, the labor, the one who done the jumping, because they are enjoy so much for making batik, so it is okay to have low wage or something like that. But I think that's wrong, because people needs to appreciate by the work that they make, especially batik. Yes, we know that batik is a budaya adiluhung. So it means that the labor can be a hero to preserve that material of culture. But I guess if we don't careful with the labor, there's we will face lack of regeneration. I think not only the next 10 years, but even now, I see, when I go to, Sentra Batik, young generation, doesn't want to become a batik maker, because they know from their parents or their, you know, neighbors who only get less. So they don't want to, you know, make or earn money from that kind of profession. So I guess we have to be, you know, make sure that the labor also earn or even have appreciation more than they have today. At least, I hope, yeah, because I done some of the research, the labor, most of them earn less than minimum wage, monthly minimum wage. So it's really shame, actually, in my point of view, because we want to make sure that batik will last forever and make sure that the labor also earn a lot as well. But thank you, Ms. Fida.
Okay. Right. Wow. Thank you. I think it's going to be a long debate. You know, there is always a plus and minus. There will always be a debate about this. So, yeah.
But we are plus There's plus and minus, but we are plus.
Of course.
I'm
yeah.
sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, no problem, of course. I think we've got our own opinions and we should all appreciate yeah. each other's opinion, right?
Yeah.
All right. Please, everybody, I need you to be patient because I have checked the YouTube. We are still live, by the way. You are still on YouTube streaming. And we've got a question there. I want Ms. Rima to answer that. Perhaps in a very short answer. So there's a question from Miss Ferry Desnita. She asked about what you think would be the biggest challenge for batik exporters. Mm-hmm. So perhaps one big challenge for batik exporters.
Okay, that's an interesting question. I would say the biggest challenge would be the regulation. There's a strict regulation especially for small medium enterprises to export their product outside of the country. They have to meet like a standard that is very high. And another thing is each country treat different regulation. So we have to make sure that the product meets that standard. I think that's the big challenge, especially when we say the small, medium enterprises, but the government also provide some kind of program to make sure that small, medium enterprises acknowledge the standard, the regulation, and then maintain it well so they can accept it to the international standard, international market. Thank you for the question.
Right. Yeah, wow. Yeah, that's, I think, great answer. Thank you, Ms. Rima and Ms. Ferry. I hope that answers your question. All right, everybody, I think we have finished all our agenda tonight. You have heard what Miss Rima says about batik industry, and everyone had fun discussing, and we've got also good presentations here from the group. So now I think I would like to ask you to fill out a feedback form for us. Okay, I'm going to share the link in the chat box. You can check it there. Wait. Is it there already?
Yes.
Can you check it? Yes, okay. So please, I'll give you some time to fill it out now. Okay. Music here. Okay. Thank you.
that you're bringing me on. I've been waiting so long, and this love.
All right. Have you finished? Yes.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Good. Anyone needs more time? Perhaps one more hour? No. Okay.
No. Thank you.
Right. All right. Great. Okay. I think we've come to our last agenda. Okay, hang on.
Finished?
I want to share something.
Yes. Oh, okay. Good. Anyone needs more time? Perhaps one more hour? No? Okay.
No, thank you.
Right. All right. Great. Okay.
I got a sound from somewhere. Hang on. There's something. Okay. Right. Okay. Wait. Oh, I forgot. I want to share something here. Wait. Ah. Okay. Can you see my screen already? No. Again.
No.
Whoops. No. Oh no.
Again.
Wait. Okay. Wait. It's loading. Can you see it now?
Yes.
Yay. So you know what it is, I think. Okay, we've got two vouchers to give away. Okay, and I already asked your facilitators and they say those who deserve the vouchers tonight are, drum rolling please. We've got Rosita from group four. Are you there?
Yes, Miss.
Miss Rosita. Oh, right there. There she is. Congratulations. Okay. And yeah, surprised, huh? Hope you're happy with it. Okay, and we've got one more also. Oh no, it's not from group four, it's from group two. Okay, from group two. I bet your heart is beating faster now. We've got Mas Nizar. Mas Nizar?
Yes, ma'am.
Ah, there. Mas Nizar Sadat. Congratulations. You got the voucher. One of the team member from Cilacs will contact both of you. Congratulations. Okay, and well, I'm moving on. There. That was our picture. Okay, right. Okay. If you think you didn't have good pose, just let me know. I'll take I'll take a shot for you, special for you only. Okay. All right. Next. I just want to wrap this meeting with today's speak. So what I got from what I want to highlight from Ms. Rima's presentation and discussion, and also your discussion, is that batik is a pride which shapes who we are today. Is that it, Ms. Rima?
Yes, it's true.
Yes. All right, great. Thank you. So that's our today's speak. Okay, and one more. Okay, what do you think? Next week, okay, we're going to have also interesting topic. Okay, tonight's topic is really interesting. I'm so excited. And next week, of course, we've got also exciting topic here. There's going to be Mas Saras Jatmiko. He's a post-crosser. You know what post-crosser is? If you don't know, because me neither, then I think we should come next week to find out. All right. He's going to present, oh, we've got the title here, Make Friends from All Around the World Through Postcards. Oh, so I think you know what that means. Postcard, post-crossers. Okay, there's already a picture. Okay, good. Make sure you don't miss our next week's session. Okay, everyone. And I think that's a wrap. Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Rima, for the great presentation. Thank you, the team, for your big support. And everyone, of course, big thanks to you for joining our class tonight. I think I'll see you again next week, of course. Take care. Have a good rest and good night, everyone. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.